Father, it's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know they're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. So unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, love, love. Your
welcome to the Parish of Central Saanich pre-recorded service. This service today will come to you from both St. Mary's and St. Stephen's, and I just want to say to you that my prayer for each of us this day on the Indigenous Day of Prayer in Canada is that we would have an experience of God which replaces what is sometimes just a whole bunch of information about God. We're here to experience the living God in our lives and pray for that to be the case today. And as always, we acknowledge the land we're on today. Fern Perkins is going to do that for us. Thank you, Fern.
On this National Indigenous Day across Canada, I would like to acknowledge that the Parish of Central Saanich is a grateful visitor to the land of the Saanich First Nation. And we are learning to walk well together with our villages and our four communities of Saout, Sartleep, Saakum, and Pequotchin. And we are very grateful to be here on this unceded and unsurrendered land as guests who have been well treated and made welcome. And it is a great honor to be able to acknowledge that. And I'd like to say Hashkasiam to our neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Claimed as God's own.
We are called from our darkness into the light of God's day.
The Spirit of the Lord renews the face of the earth. O come, let us worship. In the beginning, before time, before people, before the world began,
God was
here and now among us, beside us, enlisting the people of earth for the purposes of heaven.
God is.
In the future, when we have turned to dust and all we know has found its fulfillment,
God will be.
Not denying the world, but delighting in it. Not condemning the world, but redeeming it. Through Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit.
God was, God is, God will be. Glory to the Father, and the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Let us pray. In you, gracious God, the widowed find a carer, the orphaned find a parent, the fearful find a friend in you. And if some say, some need to say, help me, and if some need to say, save me, and if some need to say, hold me, and if some need to say, forgive me, then let these be said now in confidence by us. Let us hold a moment of silence. As we come out of our silent time, let us continue in prayer and remember. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Have no anxiety about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Great is the Lord and worthy of all praise.
Amen. Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving and honor, power and might, be to our God forever and ever. Amen.
O Christ, in whose heart is both welcome and warning, say to us, do to us, reveal within us the things that will make us whole. And we will wait, and we will praise.
Amen. Amen.
Creator God, from you every family in heaven and earth takes its name. You have rooted and grounded us in your covenant love and empowered us by your Spirit to speak the truth in love and to walk in your way towards justice and wholeness. Mercifully grant that your people journeying together in partnership may be strengthened and guided to help one another to grow in the full stature of Christ, who is our light and our life.
Amen. Amen.
Let us be attentive to hearing God's word.
Today's Old Testament reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 25 to 31. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see, who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, and not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known, have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait up for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles, and they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Hear what the Spirit of God is saying. Thanks be to God.
Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another. Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard, their sound has gone out into all lands, and their message to the ends of the world. In the deep has he set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course. It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again. Nothing is hidden from its burning heat. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can tell how often he offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound, and innocent of a great offense. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Amen. Now today's epistle, it's a reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellent, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Hear what the Spirit is saying.
Thanks be to God.
What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
God be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, and yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him and who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known." This is the gospel of Christ.
Thanks to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May only the truth be spoken and only the truth be heard. Amen. Good people of the parish of Central Saanich, it's good to be with you in this way today. I wish I were with you in person. The time is soon coming, I think, when we will be able to greet one another face to face, but for now, this will have to suffice. Today is the summer solstice. It's the day we celebrate the Aboriginal Day of Prayer. And I think about the fact that this happens on the summer solstice. And I think about the ways we tell time. The parish I served in Calgary bordered the Tsuut'ina Nation, and I came over the time I was there to learn something of the ways of that nation. I learned that for them, the first day of the year was marked by the first thunderstorm. Usually in Calgary, that would happen in very late May, early June. And so with time, they said that it was June 1st. That was the way they set their time. But the chiefs and the elders would laugh about that and say, well, that's just us kind of giving in to the ways of the world. Really, it's the first day there's thunder. But the kids and the schools needed to know what day was Sutina Day and what day they would get a free day out of school, and so it became June 1st. The Aboriginal Day of Prayer is always on the summer solstice, but this year it falls on a Sunday, which is helpful for us. It's a day when we are called to stop and to give thanks for the tremendous gifts and potential of the hundreds and thousands of nations of peoples who call this land home. And it's also a time for us to pause and reflect on the tremendous challenges those same nations and communities face. This year, the first reading that suggested we read for the Aboriginal Day of Prayer is from the wonderful and hopeful book of Isaiah. We heard today that God does not grow faint or weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary. The young will fall exhausted, but those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. One of the unfortunate things we do as humans is we become cynical. Sometimes we have good reason to be cynical. The church, politicians, people disappoint us. And we stop believing in, or maybe we stop hoping for change. A while ago, I saw an editorial cartoon that pictured Justin Trudeau at the door of the home of an Indigenous person, saying that he promises reconciliation and repentance for residential schools. And the Indigenous man in the cartoon is pictured saying, "Well, that's all very nice, but I'm still waiting for clean water." And in a lot of ways, that summarizes the situation we're in Canada right now. On both sides, I think there's sometimes a fair amount of cynicism about whether we're really going to get to change. People are simply unable to see a way out of the dysfunctional systems we have created, unable to believe in healing and reconciliation and truth. I often come back to the work of Quaker Parker Palmer, and he talks about how our role in life, our calling as Christians, is to live in what he calls the tragic gap. He says we're to live in this place where we see all that is wrong with the world, but where we do not lose hope for how the world could be. Sitting in between those two things is sitting in the tragic gap. And he says we are called to do that without falling into cynicism or naive idealism. To be a faithful person, he says, is to live in the tragic gap. I think he's right. Cynicism is very easy. People sit on Facebook or whatever social media platform they choose, and they just relish in cynicism. Cynicism about the church, cynicism about society, cynicism about homelessness in our communities, peace in Palestine and Israel, whatever it is. And while I understand the temptation to cynicism, I think cynicism can actually be very selfish. Often I think we fall into cynicism because it protects us from action, it protects us from responsibility, it protects us from seeing our own complicity in the problem and our own potential to be part of the solution. If we're honest, it's actually very easy to be cynical. To simply say the church will never change, the diocese will never change, the government will never change, the world will never change. What we're really saying is, I give up. I give up my own responsibility to help, to love, to serve, to work for love and justice and the reign of God. God is never cynical. We might get tired, but as today's reading from Isaiah reminds us, God does not tire. And God gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even those youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall away exhausted, but those who wait for the Lord will renew their strength and shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. God is always and everywhere hope. God is always and everywhere resurrection. God is always and everywhere rebirth. When we think there is no way, God is always showing us a way. When we think there is nothing but a tomb, God shows us that the tomb is empty and Jesus has gone on ahead of us. When we are stuck, Jesus is always five or six steps ahead of us, showing us the possibilities of love, of justice, of the kingdom. If we truly believe in God, if we truly accept our God-given gifts and abilities, we really have no reason or no excuse to be cynical. For what we have, my friends, is the eternal power and strength of the one God of all time and all space, working in and through us, renewing our strength and raising us on eagle's wings. Showing us possibilities we could not see, giving us strength we didn't think we had, building relationships we did not think were possible. I've heard a little bit from Lon about the mutual relationships of trust between the villages of this place and the churches of this place in Central Saanich. May God bless you and be present to you as you build those relationships, as you nurture those relationships. This past weekend, I had the privilege of traveling to Alert Bay, to the Namgis Nation, the site of St. Michael's, a residential school we Anglicans ran for too many years in that part of the world. I spent all of Sunday afternoon sitting and listening to the stories of survivors of that school, some of whom were sent to that school, were taken to that school, as young as three. And the whole time I was on that island, as soon as I looked out a window, much like your beautiful window here, I would see an eagle. Eagles were everywhere on that island. Monday morning, as we prepared to get back on the ferry, there were seven eagles sitting in one tree. I don't know what eagles do when seven of them get together, but it was quite a sight to behold. Bishop Logan was there at St. Michael's in 2015 when that school was demolished, when they threw rocks at the school, when they took that school down. And he was given an eagle feather, a symbol of honor and a sign of connection between Creator and people. And when I was consecrated as bishop, he passed that feather on to me, and I took that feather with me to Alert Bay, and I see the feather here this morning on the t-shirt. And then we have today's scripture about eagle's wings. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Today, on the Aboriginal Day of Prayer, I invite you to reflect on what you may or may not be cynical about. What in your personal life? What in your life as a church? What about your life in society? Where might cynicism be creeping in? When we pray the Lord's Prayer, we pray, "Lead us not into temptation," but I think another translation of that could be, "Lead us not into cynicism." For God's kingdom is only going to come when we have hope. God's kingdom is only going to come when we trust in the ongoing power and presence of God to renew our strength, to help us mount up like eagles, to embody in our time, in our place, the redeeming and resurrecting and reconciling love of God. And I have hope that the work of reconciliation is going to be a bit like being on eagle's wings. Eagles are big. They're really very large birds. And those first few flaps as they get out of the tree must be hard work, right? Getting that large mass of bird moving. But then they catch the wind. Then they soar. And I think the work of reconciliation for us might be a little bit the same. The first few flaps are really hard work. They're a little bit uncomfortable. We feel off balance. We're not quite sure if it's worth the effort. But it's not all about us. And the wind and the spirit will lift us. If we just launch ourselves off that tree, if we just take the first steps. The other thing I want to talk to you about this morning at Central Saanich is COVID. We are about to be back together in person, I really truly believe and hope. But the question for us is, what have we learned? What have we learned about gathering? What have we learned about compassion? What have we learned about connection? What have we learned about isolation? What have we learned about poverty? What have we learned about resurrection during COVID? How can we re-enter our buildings and be more faithful, more welcoming, more inclusive, more loving, and perhaps, dare I say it, more flexible? God is not finished with us yet. And we need to pay attention. We need to listen for the voice of the Spirit whispering to us of God's dreams, of God's intentions, of God's hope for the church and for the world. And we need to remember that as tired and cynical as we might sometimes feel, those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Amen.
As we absorb the words of Scripture and the words of our bishop today, let us say together the affirmation of our faith, the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And now Greg will lead us in a time of prayer.
We'll start with the litany, and the responses are in the bulletin. Holy Creator, in whom all things in heaven and earth have their being, have mercy on us. Risen Christ, through whom the whole creation is reconciled to God, have mercy on us. Life-giving Spirit, whose love and truth fills the world and searches the depths of our lives,
have mercy on us.
Blessed Trinity, source of both unity and diversity,
have mercy on us.
From our failure to recognize and respect the revelation of your truth and love in the first peoples of this land,
Savior, forgive and heal us.
From our participation in the systemic oppression of indigenous sovereignty, language, culture, and spirituality,
Savior, forgive and heal us.
From our role in the Indian residential schools, designed to eliminate the unique society, wisdom, and beauty of the indigenous peoples of this land.
Savior, forgive and heal us.
From our complicit tolerance of the decimation of indigenous family structures, leaving children vulnerable to abuses of every kind.
Savior, forgive and heal us.
From our continued acceptance of unjust legal, educational, health, and social structures that continue to oppress and destroy the lives of many indigenous people.
Savior, forgive and heal us.
We pray for all leaders of church and community, including the Anglican Church of Canada, Linda, Lynn, and Mark, Anna, our bishop, Eric and Saints Christopher and Aidan, Lake Cowichan Bishop Leslie, and the Diocese of Yukon, and for Father Rolf and the people of the Roman Catholic Saanich Peninsula Parish. We hold up to you in prayer all those in need as mentioned in our bulletin and known only to you. O God, we pray for the gifts of your grace and your love, which never gives up on us and is forever faithful. Inspire our minds with a vision of the reconciliation of your kingdom in this time and place.
Hear us, O Christ.
Touch our eyes that we may see the sacredness of all creation.
Hear us, O Christ.
Touch our ears that we may hear from every mouth of every peoples the hunger for hope and stories of refreshment.
Hear us, O Christ.
Lord, we pray for your blessing on our community of Central Saanich and surrounding communities where we have our homes. We pray for your blessing on the new supportive housing site being built on East Saanich. We pray, Lord, that the residents would harmonize well with the community as they receive the help and support they need. We pray, Lord, for guidance on what our role should be in regards to this project. We give thanks for our own families and for families everywhere. We pray for loving wisdom for parents as they raise and nurture the future generations. For all of us, Lord, we pray for hearts that love our individual family members as you have loved us. Let us hold each other in unconditional love and service to one another. We pray, Lord, for the end of the COVID pandemic. We pray for the effectiveness, the measures that are being taken to end it. We pray for a full recovery of all those worldwide who have contracted the virus. We pray for those who have lost loved ones, and we pray for those who are facing the partial or complete loss of income as a result of the pandemic. We will now have a time to pray for all those on our hearts, either silently or out loud, and that you will touch their lives with your love and healing.
For Nicholas, for Joe,
for Nikki,
for Fred and Sue,
for Brad and Kim. Give thanks, Lord. For Jamie. Don's business, Lord. We pray, Lord, that our lives will model the life to come, when you will bring about the resurrection of all things in a renewed world where the wolf lies down with the lamb and with true joy and peace for all. With the power of your Holy Spirit, may we be Christ-like people, living lives of Christ-like love. As always, Lord, we pray that your will be done. Amen.
Amen.
Continuing our prayers and praises into one, let us sing as our Savior taught us.
Glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us confess our sins to God. God of mercy, we have sinned against you and against others. We have sinned in what we have done and in what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for our sins, forgive us all that is past and raise us to newness of life. Amen. Almighty God, who pardons all who truly repent, forgive your sins, strengthen you by the Holy Spirit, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. May the peace of God be always with you.
And also, with you.
Peace.
Peace, Abby. Peace, Sander.
Peace.
Peace, Greg. Peace, Rachel. Peace, Gary. Glory to God,
whose love working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
Whoever you are and wherever you are on your journey of faith, hear the risen Christ call your name. Hear the one God of all time and of all space tell you that you are deeply, deeply loved. Hear the Spirit beckon you to follow. And may the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you this day and forevermore.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We were made to be courageous,
We were made to lead the way. We could be the generation that finally breaks the chains. We were made to be courageous. We were made to be courageous. We're warriors on the front line, standing unafraid. And our watchers on the sidelines, while our families slip away. Where are you, men of courage? You were made for so much more. Let the pounding of our hearts cry, we will serve the Lord. We were made to be courageous, and we're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous, and stars with us tonight. The only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous. Lord, make us courageous. This is our resolution, our answer to the call. We will love our wives and children and refuse to let them fall. We will reignite the passion that we bury deep inside. May the watchers become warriors, the men of God arise. We were made to be courageous, so we're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous. Tonight, the only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous, Lord, make us courageous, and we're taking back the fight. We were made to be courageous, and it starts with us tonight. The only way we'll ever stand is on our knees with lifted hands. Make us courageous, Lord, make us courageous. We were made to be courageous.
Your God.